Germany, A Winter's Tale by Heinrich Heine. Part 1. It was in November's dreary days, the year grew heavy-hearted. The wind stripped all the forests bare, for Germany I departed. And when I came to the borderline, my heart beat something fearful. Within my breast I even felt my eyes grow moist and tearful. And hearing the German language, I felt strange beyond all measure. It was as if my heart began to bleed away with pleasure. A little harp girl played and sang, her song rang true in feeling. Her voice rang false, but I was moved, I found it so appealing. She sang of love and lover's woes, of sacrifice till the morrow. We meet up in that better world that knows no pain or sorrow. She sang of this earthly vale of tears, of joy one never recaptures, of the great beyond where souls are glad, transfigured in deathless raptures. She sang the old abnegation tune, the lullaby heaven's simpers, to lull the people back to sleep, when that lummox wishes and whimpers. I know the tune, I know the words, I know its authors I'm thinking. I know how in secret they guzzle wine, and in public preach water drinking. A newer song, a better song, my friends, let's bring to birth now. We shall proceed right here to build the kingdom of heaven on earth now. We wish to be happy here on earth, all want eradicated. The idler's belly shall not consume what toiler's hands have created. The soil produces bread enough for all mankind's nutrition, plus rose and myrtle, beauty and joy, and sugar peas in addition. Yes, sugar peas for everyone, piled high upon the barrows. The heavens we can safely leave to the angels and the sparrows. And if we sprout wings after death, we'll visit the upper sections and eat with you celestial tarts and the holiest cakes and confections. A newer song, a better song, a song that's fiddled and fluted. The miserere is past and gone, the funeral bells are muted. The maiden Europa has plighted her troth to a beautiful spirit this is. The spirit of freedom they lie embraced and revel in their first kisses. The marriage is valid, although no priest has blessed it with holy waters. Long live the bridegroom and the bride and all their sons and daughters. My song's an epithalamium, a new one and a better. Within my soul new stars flare up and burn off every fetter. Inspired stars that blaze out wild in torrents of lightning and thunder. I feel a marvelous strength in me. I could break oak trees asunder. Since I set foot on German soil, a magical current flows through me. The giant has touched his mother again. New powers are pouring into me. Part 2. Well, the little girl warbled of heavenly joy and accents so uplifting. The Prussian customs men gave my bags a thorough searching and sifting. They sniffed through everything, rummaged about, through shirts and shorts for hidden, needlepoint laces and undeclared gems and for books that were forbidden. You fools, to search for them in my bags, there's everything law-abiding. I take contraband along with me, but it's in my head it's hiding. I've needlepoints finer than Brussels best, enough to needle and pin you. And once my points are bared to view, you'll feel them sticking in you. I carry diamonds in my head, the future time's crown jewel, the temple hoard of the great unknown, the god of the renewal. And many books are stowed in my head, let it be clearly stated. My head is a twittering nest of books, good enough to be confiscated. Satan's own library has nothing worse, no need for you to scoff, man. More dangerous are they than even the books of poor old Hoffman. A passenger who stood near me now offered the observation that this was the Prussian Zovarian, the great customs federation. The Zovarian, he said, will found our nationhood now blighted. It knits the divided fatherland into one that is united. It gives us external unity, the material kind the real. The censorship gives us unity of spirit, the ideal. It gives us internal unity, without dissenter or doubter. We need a Germany standing as one, a oneness both inner and outer. Part 3. In Aachen's old cathedral lies Carolus Magnus the Kaiser. Don't mix him up with Karl Mayer, who is a Swabian poetizer. I wouldn't like being buried and dead and auction for a Kaiser's exchequer. I'd much rather live as a littlest poet in Stuchart on the Neckar. In Aachen, the street dogs are bored to death. They seem to be prayerfully blurting. Please give us a kick, dear stranger, perhaps it will be a little diverting. I strolled round this tiresome hole for an hour, bored by each jot and tittle. I saw Prussian soldiery again. They've altered very little. They still are wearing the old gray cloak, the collar still red and high now. The red betokens Frenchmen's blood, sang Corner in days gone by now. These people are still the same wooden types, spout pedantic commonplaces. All motions right-angled and priggishness is frozen upon their faces. They still stalk about as straight as poles, and stiffly turned out you meet them, as if they just had swallowed the stick that once was used to beat them. Yes, the rod has never quite disappeared, but now they bear it inside them. The intimate do still reminds me of the he that was used to deride them. The long mustache is but a new form of pigtail that time discloses. The pigtail that used to hang behind hangs down now under their noses. The cavalryman's new costume is fine. To praise it is only proper. The impressive spike helmet, especially with a point of steel as the topper. It smacks of the age of chivalry, of the romantic old Duringdu land, of the Lady Joanna of Montfaucon and Baron Fouquet, Tieck, and Uhland. It suggests medieval nobles and squires, knights-errant and lords superior, who bore true faith upon their breasts, coats of arms upon their posterior. It smacks of crusades and tournaments, troth plighted and service God-fearing, of the printless age of faith when yet no daily press was appearing. Yes, yes, the helmet's magnificent, a supreme piece of wit, I like it. A right royal sally it was indeed, it has even a point to spike it. I'm only afraid such a metal point, when a storm is howling and heightening, will draw down on your romantic heads the heaven's most modern lightning. On Aachen's post office coat of arms I again saw the bird I detested, so deeply and with a venomous glare his eyes upon me rested. If you fall in my hands, you ugly bird, I'll pluck out every feather, and chop the claws off both your feet and tie them up together. I'll put you up on an airy perch, action to action suiting, and call the Rhineland's marksman too, a jolly day of bird shooting. Whoever shoots the bird for me will win the offering. Of crown and scepter, trumpets will blow, will cry, long live the king. Part 4. Late in the evening I came to Cologne. I heard the Rhine's waters flowing. I felt German air against my cheeks. I felt its influence growing. Upon my appetite I ate an omelette with ham mincing, and since it was very salty stuff, I used Rhine wine for rinsing. The Rhine wine still shines gold in mugs of the green-hued rummer mottle, and if you drink some pints too much, it goes right to your noddle. And there it titillates with delight, in a rapturous, tingling riot. It drove me out in the gathering night, to streets deserted and quiet. The old stone houses gazed at me, as if to tell me hoary legends from long-forgotten days, the holy city's story. Yes, here the clergy piously once lived and ate their mutton. Here ruled the dark obscurantist, as described by Ulrich von Hutten. And here the nuns and monks once danced, can-cans of the Middle Ages. Hochstraten, like Menzel, wrote poison-filled denunciatory pages. Here books and men were burned at the stake, while pious bells were rung out. The leaping flames devoured the pyre, and Kyrie Eleison was sung out. Stupidity mated malice here, like street dogs copulating, when still can tell their offspring by their religious heat and hating. But look, in the moonlight over there, a huge shape crystallizes. Towering upward, devilish black, Cologne's cathedral rises. It was built to be the mind's Bastille, the crafty papists plotted, to keep German thought in this huge jail, to languish till it rotted. Then Luther came and spoke the word. His halt was strong and splendid, and from that day the building of the cathedral was suspended. It was not finished, a good thing too, for in this unfinished condition, it's a monument to Germany's strength and to the Protestant mission. Poor devils of the Cathedral League, your arms are too weak to continue. To build this unfinished citadel, to the past it isn't in you. Oh, foolish illusion, to shake and pass, the collection box is bootless. To beg from heretics even, and Jews, it's all so vain and fruitless. In vain the great Franz Liszt will play, for cathedral fund donations. In vain a talented king will make, imploring declamations. The cathedral will never be finished indeed, though Swabian fools make a production of sending a shipload of building stones to forward its construction. It will not be finished, though ravens and owls may clamor with all their power, because they love old things and like to perch on a high church tower. Someday, instead of finishing it, I hope that we'll be able to utilize the space inside and make a good horse stable. And if it becomes a stable, then we have a problem, which is, what shall we do with the three holy kings who rest there in their niches? The question's asked, the need is there, but why bother right now to fill it? The three holy kings from the east can find some other place to build it. Take my advice and stick them in, the three iron cages that glower, down from the church in Munster where they hang in St. Lambert's Tower. The tailor king once sat therein with two of his council sages, but it's for some other majesties that now we need those cages. Put Lord Balthazar upon the right, on the left be Melchior suspended. In the middle Lord Gaspar, God knows how the three made out ere their lives were ended. The Holy Alliance of the East, now canonized as a savior, perhaps it hasn't always shown such canonical behavior. Balthazar and Melchior may have been fools who sought a safe solution, when they felt the pinch of the people's demands and promised a constitution, and later failed to keep their word, the Moorish King Gaspar accorded black thanklessness to his foolish land, and thus were his people rewarded. Part 5. And when I came to the bridge on the Rhine, and the harbor bastion by it, I saw old Father Rhine flowing past in the moonlight quick and quiet. Greetings to you, old Father Rhine. Say, how have things been going? So often I have thought of you with longing ever growing. I spoke and heard from the watery deep an oddly peevish groaning, as if an old man hemmed and hawed, a mumbling and feeble moaning. Welcome, my lad, I'm glad to find that you did not forget me. For the 13 years you've been away, misfortunes have beset me. At Bybridge town I swallowed stones, vile tasting without questions, but Nicholas Becker's verses are much harder on my digestion. He sang of me as if I were the purest virgin around here, who never let a man enjoy the favors that he found here. And when I hear that stupid song, I want to go uncrown me, and tear my hair and go berserk, and in myself go drown me. About my claimed virginity, the French are sure more knowing. How often have their conquering streams into my own come flowing. That stupid song, that stupid chap, he's disgracefully misprized me. To a certain extent he even has politically compromised me. For now if the French come back again, with shame my cheeks will be burning. I who so often tearfully prayed that someday I might see them returning. I've always liked them, the little dears, those Frenchmen I was introduced to. Do they sing in spring as they did before? Do they still wear white pants as they used to? I'd certainly like to see them again, but I fear being chafed when they face me, because of that cursed Becker song, because its words disgrace me. Alfred de Musset, that guttersnipe, may lead the pack to chagrin me, perhaps as a drummer boy of the troop to drum all his bad jokes in me. Thus he complained, poor Father Rhine, and nothing there was to please him. I spoke a few consoling words to comfort, soothe, and ease him. Oh, fear you not, dear Father Rhine, these jibes in the French tradition. They're not the Frenchmen of old anymore, and they wear different pants in addition. Their pants are red and no longer white, with buttons no longer clinking. They sing no more, they spring no more, their heads are weighed down with thinking. They philosophize now all over the place, Kant, Fichte, and Hegel extolling. They smoke tobacco, they guzzle beer, and many even go bowling. They're becoming Philistines just like us, and even more barbarian. They're becoming Hinston Burgerites. You can hardly find a Voltairian. Musset is still a gutter snipe. It's true, and baits his betters. Fear not, we'll have his vile sharp tongue tied up in 1,000 fetters. If he drums up one of his bad jokes, we'll whistle one worse than the French's. We'll whistle a tune to tell the world how he's made out with the winches. Cheer up, Father Rhine, forget all these bad songs of a second rater. You'll soon be hearing a better song, farewell, farewell, see you later.
Part 6.
Paganini was always accompanied by a spiritus familiaris, who sometimes took the form of a dog, sometimes of the late George Harris. Napoleon saw a red man plain, before every expedition. Socrates had his daemon, too. It wasn't an apparition. I, too, have seen, as I sat at my desk, at work in the night time mostly, the muffled form of a guest that stood behind me dim and ghostly. Beneath the cloak was something hid that gleamed when the lamplight caught it. It seemed to me it was an axe, a headsman's axe, I thought it. Square-built he stood, with eyes like stars, that shone with strange insistence. He never disturbed me as I wrote, but quietly kept his distance. I had not seen this singular chap for years through health and illness, until I suddenly found him here in Cologne town's moonlit stillness. Musing, I strolled along the street. Behind me he came stalking. Just like a shadow, if I stopped, he also would stop walking. He'd stop, as if awaiting. What? He dogged my steps, this riddle. And so we came to Cathedral Square. He followed me into the middle. Unbearable, I turned and said. I demand an explanation. Why do you dog me nightly through this urban desolation? I always meet you when I feel grand cosmic thoughts start stirring within my breast and in my brain, vast inspirations whirring. You gaze at me with staring eyes. What do you hide from viewing? Beneath your cloak that shines so strange, who are you? What are you doing? He answered me. The tone was dry and even a bit phlegmatic. No exorcism, if you please, and kindly don't get so emphatic. I am no phantom from the past, no spectral apparition. I am no lover of rhetoric, nor much of a dialectician. I am a practical type with a practical job, and quietly I go to it. For no, whatever your mind thinks up, I carry it out, I do it. Though years may pass, I do not rest until with care exacting, I make your thoughts realities, you think I do the acting. You are the judge, the bailiff, I, as obedient servants must one, carry out any sentence that you passed, whether or not it's a just one. In Roman acts was carried before a consul, may I remind you. You too have your lictor, but nowadays the axe is carried behind you. I am your lictor, in the rear, you always hear the clink of the headsman's axe that follows you, I am the deed you think of.
Part 7.
Homeward I went, and slept as if, on angel clouds outspreading, one rests so soft on German beds, because it's feather bedding. When I lie on a mattress that's hard as a board, oh then, just like a reflex I'll yearn for the fatherland's bolster beds, and the sleepless night of exile. On feather beds like ours one can sleep well and dream even better. It's here a German soul feels free from every earthly fetter. That soul feels free, and wings on high, to a heaven glowing and gleaming. O German soul, how nobly you soar, at night when you are dreaming. The gods grow pale when you approach, up there in heaven's dominions. There's many a starlet you've snuffed out with the beating of your pinions. The land is held by the Russians and French, the seas by the British invested, but in the airy realm of dreams our sway is uncontested. Here we exist, unfragmented, and rule without a murmur. The other nations of the earth developed on terra firma. When I fell asleep, I dreamed again. I strolled where the moonlight laces the echoing streets of old Cologne and all its ancient places. My dark companion followed still, behind me without slowing. I was so tired my knees gave in, but still we kept on going. We kept on going, in my breast an open wound was gaping, and from the gashes in my heart red droplets were escaping. Sometimes I dipped my finger in, and sometimes on the quiet, I'd daub a house's doorpost with the blood as we passed by it. And every time I passed a house and marked it in this fashion, I heard a funeral bell afar, tolling with soft compassion. In heaven now the moon grew pale, and darker grew the gloaming. Wild welling clouds come racing in, like night-black horses foaming. The muffled figure followed still, behind me axe still holding, and on we spode for quite a while, and still we kept on striding. We walked and walked until at last we reached the cathedral center. Wide open stood the cathedral doors, and through them did we enter. In that enormous space there reigned night's silence and death austerely. Some hanging lamps burned here and there to show the dark more clearly. I walked along the columns and heard only echoing hollow the steps of my companion who close behind did follow. At last we came to a place lit up with myriad candles to dapple the gold and jeweled ornaments. It was the Three Kings' chapel. But the three holy kings who used to lie so still in their funeral trusses, wonder of wonders, they sat up now upon their sarcophaguses. Three skeletons sat, fantastically decked, beneath the crowns their glower. The yellowed skulls their bony hands bear the scepters of royal power. Like mannequins their dead bones stirred in movements long forgotten, and from them rose a mingled reek of incense and mold gone rotten. One of them even moved his lips and gave a long disquisition. He explained to me why I should have respect for his condition. First of all, because he was dead, and second, a king, to speak rightly, and third, a saint. Such was his case, it moved me only slightly. I laughed in his face and gave this reply, "In vain your labored oration. I see that you belong to the past in every respect and relation. Away with you, go back to the graves, made to your proper measure. Now life comes in to confiscate this chapel's costly treasure. The future's cavalry of joy will use this place for its quarters, and if you don't go willingly, I'll have you clubbed out by my orders." I spoke, and turning round I saw the fearsome axe shining brightly in my mute companion's fearsome hands, and he read my signal rightly. He stepped up with the axe to do the task of demolition, and ruthlessly he smashed the poor skeletons of superstition. The axe strokes rang from vault to vault, it echoes without number, and spurts of blood shot from my breast, I suddenly woke from slumber. Part 8. The fare from Cologne to Hagen is 5 Prussian thalers, 6 groschen. The coach was full, an open chaise was my means of locomotion. The chaise went wheezing through the mud, the damp autumn morning was gloomy, but despite bad weather and ways I felt a zesty well-being all through me. Yes, this was my homeland's native air, it glows on my cheeks like fire, and all this mud on the highway is my fatherland's very own mire. The horses' tails wagged friendly wise as on they went clip-clopping. Their little dung cakes seemed just as fair as the apples Atalanta kept dropping. We drove through Mülheim. The town is nice. Its folk are hard-working and quiet. The year 31 in the month of May was the last time I came by it. Then everything was blooming bright. The sunbeams were laughing and winking. The birds were singing their yearning songs, and the people were hoping and thinking. They were thinking, "These scrawny overlords will soon go away, we don't need them. From long iron bottles we'll offer them a stirrup cup to speed them. And freedom will come with dancing and sport, with its flag, the white, blue, and red one. Perhaps you'll even bring back from the grave old Bonaparte, the dead one. Good heavens, these lords are still around, and many who came on short rations. Poor ninnies who used to be thin as a rail now have potbelly corporations. These pallid wretches, who used to look like love, faith, and hope in prim poses, have been swizzling our Rhinish wine since then and got themselves ruddy noses. And freedom has sprained her ankle since then and no longer can romp and revel. On Paris towers the tricolor droops, dejected as the devil. The emperor has risen up since then, but those English worms finally made him a very grave man and well-behaved, and back in the tomb they laid him. I saw his funeral rites myself, saw the golden hearse go faring, bedecked with golden victories, the golden coffin bearing. Along the champs Ulysses they marched, through mist and snowfall blended, and through the arch of triumph too, the slow procession winded. The music was playing all out of tune, stiff with cold the musicians. The eagles on the banners looked like doleful apparitions. The people looked lost in memory, like ghosts of another era. The dream of empire rose again, the fairy tale chimera. I wept that day, my eyes filled up, with tears my heart was pounding, when I heard that long dead cry of love, Vive l'Empereur, resounding.
Part 9. I'd left for Cologne 7:45, as the morning sun was shining. We came to Hagen toward 3 o'clock, and there we stopped for dining. The table was spread, and here I found the good old German cooking. Fair sauerkraut, hail, how good you smell. You never were better looking. Stewed chestnuts and cabbage my mother used to make it that way precisely. All hail, ye homey codfish, too. You swim in the butter so nicely. A sensitive heart loves the fatherland, and nothing can ever chill it. I also love a well-browned plate of eggs and herring fillet. How the sausages reveled in sizzling fat, the trushes and applesauce fritters, were gentle roasted angels that sweetly welcomed me with twitters. They chirped, "Welcome back, dear countryman, we noted your long defection. You've hung around abroad so long, with birds of a foreign complexion." Upon the table stood a goose, in all of her kindly splendor. Perhaps she once had loved me when we both were still young and tender. She looked at me so meaningly, with sorrow and faith together. No doubt she possessed a beautiful soul, but her flesh was tough as leather. A boar's head served on a pewter dish was also brought in with a moral. With us it's still the swine that have their snouts adorned with laurel.
Part 10. Soon after Hagen the darkness fell, and I felt a chill spread over me. At last we came to Unatown, where the tavern was able to warm me. A pretty girl was there, who poured a punch that was warming and mellow. Her eyes were soft as moonlight beams, her hair was silken yellow. I heard those thrilling Westphalian tones, more pleasant than any others. The punch exhaled sweet memories, I thought of those dear brothers. My Westphalian brothers in Göttingen, who drank with me while they were able, until we sank in each other's arms, and then sank under the table. Those dear old, good old Westphalians, my love for them is unflagging. A people so steadfast and sure and true, without any bluster or bragging. They look so fine on the dueling ground, lion hearts every Tom, Dick, and Harry. Their blows struck true, their arm was straight in every thrust and parry. They fought like men, they drank like men, as friends there were none more gentle. Shaking your hand in friendship they wept, their oaks but sentimental. God keep you, good people, and bless your fields, give you cheer and song and story, preserve you from war and from renown, from heroes and their glory. God grant that your sons get easy exams, in which they never falter, and that your daughters always bring rich husbands to the altar.
Part 11. This is the forest of Teutoburg, which Tacitus travelogued in. This is the classic muddy swamp that Varus' legions got bogged in. Here they fought the Cheruscan chief, Great Hermin, our noble sire. The German nation rose in triumph out of this muck and mire. If Hermin's sword and his blonde hordes hadn't won out over their foemen, there'd have been no German liberty, and we'd have become all Roman. We'd all talk in a Roman tongue, and dress in a Roman tunic. See Swabians called Quirites and Vestal Virgins even in Munich. Hengstenberg would be a soothsayer, through oxen entrails sifting. Neanderthal's auger would watch the birds to see where the wind was shifting. Birch Pfeiffer would tipple on turpentine, Roman ladies found it compelling. It said it made their urine become particularly sweet-smelling. Raumer would not be a German rogue, but a Roman one, a rogacious. And Freiligrath would write unrhymed verse, as once did the great Horatius. That loutish beggar, Father Jan, would now be called Lautianus. Me Hercule, Massman would talk Latin prose as Marcus Tullius Massmanus. The friends of truth would face lions now, and hyenas loosed from their cages, in Roman arenas instead of dogs, and swine in a little rag's pages. We'd have but a single sovereign, only one and not three dozen narrows. We'd all be opening our veins by now to defy his henchmen like heroes. Our shelling would be a Seneca, and he'd die as the sovereign's victim. We'd tell our painter Cornelius, cacatum non est pictum. Praise God, the Romans were driven off, and the victory was Hermann's. Varus went down with his legionnaires, and we are still good Germans. We're German still, and German we speak, and no other language whatever. An ass is an ass, not an assinus, a Swabian as ever. Our Raumer is still a German rogue, and gets a medal to bore us. Freiligrath writes in rhyming verse, he hasn't become a Horace. Our Massman speaks no Latin, praise God, Birch Pfeiffer only writes dramas. Instead of drinking vile turpentine, like the Romans Amoris Mamas. O Hermin, we owe this all to you, so at Detmold with fitting devotion, of monuments being raised to you, I've contributed a few groschen. Part 12. The carriage lumbered through nighttime woods, and then, as if to grieve me, a wheel broke off, we came to a halt. It was not very pleasant, believe me. The driver got down and hurried away, to the village, and there I found me. At midnight alone in the pitch-black woods, I heard a howling around me. It is the wolves that howl so wild, their hungry voices are screaming. Like torchlights in the inky dark, their fiery eyes are gleaming. They must have heard I'm coming here, and thought it only decorous, to honor me in their savage way, with a light show and a chorus. It's a serenade, I see it now, my visit's to be celebrated. I immediately struck the proper pose and with moving gestures orated. My fellow wolves, I'm happy to be with you at this meeting, where so many noble spirits howl, their love to give me greeting. My feelings at this moment are impossible to measure. This hour will be eternally an unforgettable treasure. I thank you for your confidence, which honors me sincerely. Which you vouchsafed for me in time of trial, as experience shows so clearly. Fellow wolves, you never doubted me, nor believed the rascals around you, who told you I'd gone over to the sight of the dogs that hound you. That I was a turncoat who soon would be boss of the lambs, a fiction. It would be beneath my dignity to issue a contradiction. The sheepskin that I wore at times was purely worn to warm me. My fervor about the poor sheep's lot never became very stormy. I am no sheep, I am no dog, not a boss nor a bull, nor a bullfish. I remain a wolf, as I've always been. My heart and my teeth are wolfish. I am a wolf, and I'll howl with the wolves as long as I can yelp. You can count on me and help yourselves, then even God will help you. That was the speech I gave to them, without any preparation. Kolb's Allgemeine published it with a little mutilation. Part 13. The sun rose over by Paderborn with a look of tired vexation. It had to light the stupid earth, a tiresome occupation. When one side's lit, it hurries to give the other the light assigned it. No sooner done, the first grows dark, and nightfall follows behind it. Sisyphus stone, can it be rolled up? The Danaides bucket, how can it be ever filled, in vain the sun tries to shed light on this planet. And when the morning mist dissolved, I saw on the road before me the shape of the man they crucified, as the early sun reddened over me. The sight of you saddens me every time, poor cousin of mine, poor dreamer. You who wanted to save the world, you fool, you mankind redeemer. They played a dirty trick on you, those counselors and their high stations. Who told you to speak so recklessly on church and state relations? Unlucky for you, the printing of books was not yet invented. Suggestion? You would have written a book, of course, entitled The Heaven Question. Any pointed remarks about Earth would be cut by the censor's interdiction, and thus the censorship's kindly care would have saved you from crucifixion. If only that sermon on the mount had been phrased a bit less rudely, you could have spared those pious folk and used your talents more shrewdly. Money changers and bankers, you drove them out of the temple along with your brothers. Poor dreamer, now you hang on the cross as a warning example to others. Part 14. A humid wind, a barren land. The carriage joggles through mire. But through my mind this sings and rings, sun, you accusing fire. This is the olden song's refrain I heard my nurse often singing. Sun, you accusing fire, it pealed like a forest horn far ringing. The song's about a murderer who leads a gay life as he pleases. At last he's found hanged on a willow branch, swinging in the breezes. The murderer's sentence was nailed to the trunk beneath the willow briar. The vemic avengers had done this deed. Sun, you accusing fire. The sun was accuser, it blazoned the crime. It was the testifier. With her dying breath, Attilia had cried, sun, you accusing fire. The song makes me think of the dear old nurse who sang to me, cherished me, scolded. I see once again her dear brown face, all wrinkled and furrowed and folded. In Munster country she was born, and knew many old tales mostly, fearsome fables and ballads and myths, and stories ghoulish and ghostly. My heart would throb when the old woman told of one of the royal princesses who sat alone on the barren heath and combed her golden tresses. A goose girl she was and tended the geese, and when the day was dying, she'd drive them home through the village gate and stand in the dusk there crying. For over the gate was a horse's head, nailed there as if to warn her. It was the head of the poor old steed that from her home had borne her. The princess sighed, O Falada, to think they have hung your head here. The horse's head looked down and cried, alas, to think you fled here. The princess sighed a heavy sigh, ah, woe, if my mother knew now. The horse's head looked down and cried, her heart would break in two now. I held my breath when nurse would talk in a lowered voice of the history of Barbarossa, old Redbeard himself, our Kaiser hidden in mystery. She assured me he wasn't dead at all, despite the savant's answers. He lives concealed in a mountainside with his men-at-arms and his lancers. The mountain's called Kaffhauser, and its cave, as stories inform us, is lit by ghostly hanging lamps. The high-vaulted halls are enormous. The first hall is a stable, and thousands of horses stand there. All harnessed up before their stalls, their gleaming gear shines grand there. They're saddled and bridled, but standing stiff, as if fixed everlasting. And not one neighs and not one stamps, they're still as an iron casting. In the second hall, on beds of straw, see thousands of soldiers lying. Their faces are bearded, their looks are fierce, their eyes are death-defying. These gallants are armed from head to foot, but out of this myriad number, not one of them moves, not one of them stirs, quiet they lie and slumber. In the third hall see the swords and spears, the battle axes up-piling, armor and helmets of silver and steel, firearms of ancient styling. Artillery's weak, but still enough to make a trophy of it. A banner colored black, red, gold towers up high above it. The Kaiser lives in the fourth great hall. He sits for an age without ending. on a seat of stone, at a table of stone, his head on his arms unbending. His beard is growing to the ground, flaming red and florid. Sometimes he seems to blink an eye, sometimes he knits his forehead. Is he sleeping fast or thinking deep? There's no knowing, no inferring. But when the right hour comes along, he will rouse with a mighty stirring. He'll seize the good old banner then, to horse, he'll be crying. His men will awake with a clanking din from the ground where they are lying. His men will swing upon their steeds that stand there stamping and neighing. They'll ride out clattering through the world, their trumpets blaring and braying. Their sleep is done, they'll ride and fight to victory unresisted. Then the Kaiser will try the murderers with justice iron-fisted. The murderers who slew the fair object of our desire, the gold-tressed maiden Germany, sun you accusing fire. And many who thought themselves safe and secure in their castles, lords, and bosses, will not escape their roper wrath, those avengers of Barbarossa's. Old nurses' tales, how dear they sound, what sweet dreams they inspire. My superstitious heart is cheered, sun, you accusing fire. Part 15. A fine prickly rain like needle points is falling, chilling, and wetting. The horses are sadly wagging their tails, they're wading through mud and sweating. The coachman's horn goes toot-a-toot-toot, I know the tune he's blowing. Three riders go riding out of the gate, my drowsiness is growing. I was sleepy and soon I fell asleep, and lo, a dream came over me. I was in the magic mountain with Redbeard the Kaiser before me. No longer he sat by the table of stone, like a statue stone-cemented, nor did he look so respectable as usually represented. He waddled with me through the halls, with familiar chit-chat at leisure. Like an antiquarian, he showed me all of his curio collection and treasure. In the armory hall, he showed me how one club from the next to determine. He rubbed the rust from several swords with the hem of the royal ermine. He took a whisk of peacock plumes and dusted like a farmer to clean cuirasses and helmet spikes and various pieces of armor. He dusted the banner as well and said, I'm proudest of all to confirm now that not one moth has eaten the silk. You can't find a single worm now. And when we came to the soldiers' hall where thousands lay ready for action, the old man turned to me and said with obvious satisfaction, speak softly here, tread lightly now, don't wake these people, heyday. 100 years have passed again, and today's again their payday. And lo, the Kaiser went to each of the soldiers sleeping for ages, and quietly stuck in each man's pouch a ducat for his wages. Chuckling, he told me with a grin, as he saw that I watched and wondered, I pay my soldiers by the years, 1 ducat per man per 100. In the hall where the battle horses stood, in long silent rows and waited, the Kaiser rubbed his hands in glee and seemed to be strangely elated. He counted the Dobbins 1 by 1 and patted their flanks approving. He counted and counted, and anxiously his lips were busily moving. The count is not yet quite correct. He's vexed as he discourses. I've plenty of soldiers and plenty of arms, but I still don't have enough horses. I sent horse dealers around the world looking to buy a hoard up of the very best horses they can find. I've now got a host of them stored up. I'm biding time till the count's complete, and then I'll strike liberating my fatherland, my good German folk, who look to me loyally waiting. Thus spoke the Kaiser, but I exclaimed, strike now, old fellow, time passes. Strike now, if you don't have horses enough, then in their place use the asses. Old Redbeard answered, smiling, there's no rush on this undertaking. Rome wasn't built in a day, you know, good cakes need longer baking. The greater the haste, the less the speed. Wise preparing is not delaying. Chi va piano va sano, slow but sure, that's an ancient Roman saying. Part 16. The carriage's jolting wakes me up, the thin rain still is streaming. But soon I doze again, I am back with Redbeard dreaming. Again we stroll through the echoing halls, again he chats and chatters. He asks me this, he asks me that, on 100 subject matters. He said all news from the upper world had been long since suspended. He hadn't heard a mortal word since the 7 years' war had ended. He asked about Moses Mendelssohn and Madame Karsh, then the stress. Gave way to questions on Du Barry, Louis XV's mistress. O Kaiser, I cried, you're way behind. Old Moses has long gone to potting, and with his Rebecca, his son Abraham is likewise dead and rotting. Abraham and Leah begot a boy named Felix, sound and steady, who's made his mark in Christendom. He's a big conductor already. Old Lady Karsh is likewise dead, and Klinka, her daughter, is dead too. Helmina Shazee, the daughter's child, still lives and breathes, or is said to. Du Barry's life was merry and gay, while Louis was there to support her. But she was already pretty old when the guillotine cut her shorter. King Louis XV died in bed, with a peaceful disposition. The 16th, however, was guillotined, and Queen Antoinette in addition. The Queen showed courage, as was right, and nothing she did was demeaning. Du Barry, however, wept and shrieked when it came to the guillotining. The Kaiser suddenly stopped, stuck still, and eyed me with fixed attention, and said, for heaven's sake, explain, what's this guillotine you mention? The guillotine, I explained to him, is for people of any position. It's a new method found to change their state from a living to a dead condition. To bring this about by modern means, they use a new machine now. Mr. Guillotin invented it, so it's called the guillotine now. They strap you tightly to a board, then lower it and shove you. Between two posts and half a wink, a three-cornered blade hangs above you. They pull a cord and so the blade shoots right down brisk and merry. In consequence, your head will drop in a sack all ready to bury. The Kaiser broke in. Enough of that. This machine talk makes me nervous. I want no more of it. God forbid that I ever need its service. The king and queen, and strapped, you say? On a board, you say, they decked them? It's against all rules of etiquette. It shows they didn't respect them. And you, who are you to dare to speak so pertly and impudently? Just wait, dear fellow, I'll clip your wings, and it won't be done very gently. It makes my blood boil high with rage to hear you talk, and with reason. Your very breath is le majeste, and the highest of high treason. As the old man snarled his rage at me, so fiercely and profanely, my inmost thoughts rose in my breast, and spoke themselves out plainly. Mr. Redbeard, I cried aloud, you're just a myth dreamed up by dreamers. Go back to sleep without your aid. We'll be our own redeemers. The Republicans would laugh us down. If you were our leader, don't doubt it. A ghost with a scepter and crown like you, they'd crack bad jokes about it. I don't like your flag anymore. Besides, way back when I was enrolled in the Burschenschaft, I lost my taste for the colors black, red, gold, and. Just stay home in your mountain here. I think that this would be wiser. When I come to think about it, we don't need any Kaiser.
Part 17. The quarrel I had with the Kaiser was just a dream, let's not forget it. When awake, you don't talk back to a prince, or if you do, you regret it. It's only when dreaming his ideal dreams that a German boldly expresses the German thoughts he bears so deep in his loyal heart's recesses. When I awoke, we were in a wood. The barren trees were gleaming, so wooden and bare, so nakedly real, they banished all my dreaming. The oak shook its head with grave concern, the birch, like a kind advisor, made warning signs. I turned and cried, forgive me, my dear Kaiser. Forgive me, Redbeard, my hasty words. I know you are much wiser than I, whose patience is so short. Come soon, after all, my Kaiser. Use the older methods of punishment if you find guillotining unpleasant, the sword for the nobleman and the rope for the burgher and the lowly peasant. But change it around every now and then. Let the noble be hung by the zealous, the burgher and the peasant beheaded somewhat. We're all God's creatures, they tell us. Bring back the code of Charles V and his hanging court's restoration, and divide the people up once more into guild, estate, corporation.
Restore the holy Roman throne to rule over Frank and German. Give us our moldy rubbish back with all its tinseled vermin. The real Middle Ages, the genuine thing, I'd endure, though nobody missed 'em. But deliver us from this bastard state, this kind of mongrel system. This mishmash aristocracy, this sickening stew of erring. Gothic fancies and modern lies, not fish, flesh, or red herring. Chase out these clowns and close the show. Be their critic and chastiser. Shut down this parody of the past. Come soon, O Kaiser! Part 18. A mighty fortress is Minden town, its ramparts give good protection. With Prussian fortresses, however, I would rather have no connection. We got there as the evening fell, the old bridge planks creaked so it was frightening as we rolled across, the dark moat yawned below it. The lofty ramparts gazed at me with irritable anger. The great gate clanged and opened up and closed with equal clangor. Ah, but my soul was sad, I felt, that nothing could ever redeem us, as Ulysses felt when the cavern was blocked with a rock by Polyphemus. A corporal came and demanded our names. What should I say in compliance? I'm no man, an oculist, and I cut cataracts from the eyes of giants. At the inn, I felt even more out of sorts. The food was stale and distressing. I went right to bed, but couldn't sleep. The bed cover's weight was oppressing. It was a very wide feather bed. Red damask curtains encased it. The canopy was of faded gold, and a dirty tassel graced it. A cursed tassel! I could not sleep. All night my nerves were jangled. It hung there threatening over my head like Damocles' sword it dangled. Sometimes it looked like a serpent's head that hissed at me stronger and stronger. You're in a fortress now for good. You can't escape no longer. I'd like to be back home, I sighed. I wish I were back there now. In Paris with my darling wife. In the Faubourg Poissonniere now. Sometimes I felt as if something brushed my forehead, something eerie. Much like a censor's icy hand, my mind grew numb and bleary. I saw gendarmes in burial shrouds and chalk-white specters flanking. My bed in a hazy whirl I heard weird sounds of chains clank-clanking. Ah woe, the specters dragged me off, and finally I found me. On the rocky side of a towering cliff, and there they tightly bound me. That cursed dirty tassel again it hovered before me. But now it looked like a vulture in black, with talons tensed to gore me. And now it's the Prussian eagle, it grips my body and pecks at my liver. It gobbles the liver from out my breast, I wail and moan and quiver. A cock crowded loud, a feverish dream, fled like its mountain setting. The eagle turned into a tassel again, and I lay in Minden sweating. I took a special post-chase on, and breathed a first sweet-smelling, free breath in Buchenberg's county air, where nature has her dwelling. Part 19. Oh, Danton, you paid for your wrong remark. You were clearly in error about it. You can take your homeland along with you on the soles of your feet, don't doubt it. About half of the district of Buchenberg has stuck to my boots and is sticking. Such muddy roads I've never seen since I've been alive and kicking. At Buchenberg town I got out to look for my family's old habitation, the mansion that saw my grandfather's birth, grandma was a Hamburg creation. I got to Hanover at noon and had my boots cleaned of muck and gravel. I went out at once to look over the town, I like to profit from travel. Good Lord, how tidy, no muddy streets. The cleanness is almost excessive. There's many a splendid building too, their size is very impressive. I especially liked the spacious square, but the stateliest homes in the city. The king lives there, his palace is there, the exterior is very pretty. That is, I mean the palaces, on each side of the entry, with musket high and visage fierce, there stands a redcoat sentry. Here, said my guide, Ernst August lives, late of the Tory party. The gentleman is old, but still, for his age, he's hale and hearty. He's safer here than with bodyguards, against riot or insurrection. The lack of guts of you-know-who is his very best protection. I see him sometimes. He always complains how boring it is to stew here, in this job of his, this royal job, which he's condemned to do here. Accustomed to England, he finds it too cramped, in a life without high endeavor. His spleen gives him trouble. He's almost afraid that he won't endure it forever. The other morning I found him stooped by the fire with no decorum. His dogs were sick. With his own royal hands, he was brewing an enema for 'em. Part 20. From Hamburg to Hamburg was 1 hour's ride. The evening glowed red and yellow. The stars in heaven beamed greetings down. The air was mild and mellow. And when I came to my mother's door, she trembled with joy to see me. She cried, "Dear child," and clapped her hands. Her eyes were moist and beamy. "My child, full 13 years have passed, and now again we meet, dear. You must be very hungry now. Say, what would you like to eat, dear?" "I have some fish and roasted goose, and also a lovely orange." "Then give me the fish and the roasted goose, and also the lovely orange." And as I ate with appetite, my mother was happy and cheery. She asked me this, she asked me that, with many a pointed query. "My child, do these foreigners look after you, and is your home really well tended? Does your wife know how to keep a house? Does she keep your stockings mended? Dear mother, the fish is very good, but a bone in the throat is unpleasant. One really should eat it without any talk. I'd rather keep quiet at present." And when I devoured the excellent fish, the goose was brought in and disjointed. And she asked about this and that, and the questions were still very pointed. "My child, where would you like to live? Where do you wish you were now? Here in this country or in France? Which people do you prefer now?" "Dear mother, the goose in Germany should satisfy any diner, but the French are better at stuffing geese, and also their sauces are finer." And when the goose bowed out, I gave my closest consideration to the lovely orange. It was sweet beyond all expectation. My mother resumed her questioning. Her manner was free and easy, but she asked about a number of things that made me very queasy. "What do you think, my child? Are your political views still strong too? What are your ideas nowadays? What party do you belong to?" "Dear mother, the orange was very good, and its sweetness was really surprising, but after enjoying its excellent juice, the rind is unappetizing." Part 21. The burned down half of the city is being slowly re-erected. Like a half-shorn poodle, woebegone, Hamburg looks sad and dejected. There's many a street that is no more, and that one ruefully misses. Where has the house now gone, where once I kissed love's first sweet kisses? Where is the printer who first gave my Reisebilder to society? Where is the oyster bar where I first ate an oyster with some anxiety? In the Dreck wall too, where has it gone? Today I would seek it vainly. Where's the pavilion I used to haunt to eat its cake tarts mainly? Where's City Hall where the Senate held sway and the burghers sat with decorum? A prey to the flames, the ravaging fire has spared no sanctum sanctorum. The people still were gasping with fear, with sorrowful lamentation. They told me the moving story of that frightful conflagration. It flared up in every corner at once, smoke pouring out, flames flashing. The church towers blazed up to the sky, and down they all came crashing. The old exchange was burned down too, where many a deal was affected. Through centuries by our fathers who dealt as honestly as could be expected. The bank, the city's silver soul, and the pages signed and dated. With everyone's bank account, praise God, they were not incinerated. Praise God, in countries far and near, they got up relief collections. A very good business it was, we got 8 million from all directions. To open our hands, the money flowed from wherever it was collected. We also accepted boxes of food, no donations were rejected. They sent us clothes and bedding enough, and bread and meat and soups too. The King of Prussia even wished to send in some of his troops too. The material damage was soon made good, that sum could be estimated, but the terrible fright we got for that, we can never be compensated. To cheer them up, I said, "Dear friends, You must not blubber and bawl so. Troy was an even finer town, yet it had to burn down also. Rebuild your houses and dry your grounds, and check your legal status. Get yourselves better laws than now, and better fire apparatus. Don't overload mock turtle soup with so much pepper and spices, and cooking carp with too much grease is one of your many vices. Turkey won't hurt you very much, but you'll get indigestion faster from the nasty bird that lays its eggs in the wig of the burgomaster. I need not name that cursed bird, if you're at all discerning. When I merely commence to think of it, my stomach commences turning.
Part 22.
Even more than the town, the people have changed. They go about glooming and gawking. With spirits broken and faces bleak, they look like ruins walking. The slim ones have grown thinner now, the plump ones now are fatter. The children are old, and the old ones are childish in things that matter. More than one who was a calf when I left has become a big ox in all candor. More than one who was a poor little goose has become a fine-feathered gander. I found old Goodle prinked out and primed like a siren and painted like lacquer. Her teeth have now become whiter than snow, and her hair has somehow got blacker. My friend the stationer's well preserved, his talents that way are aptest. His hair is yellow and halos his head, he looks like John the Baptist. I caught but a glimpse of Mr. X, as soon as he saw me he scooted. I hear his mind was burnt out, insured, by Bieber's company it's bruited. I saw my good old censor too, in the goose market, and I suspected, seeing him bent and bowed as he walked, that he felt very much dejected. I shook his hand, his eyes were wet, he held me tight, even clutching. How glad he was to see me again, the scene was very touching. Some people I missed, for many a one, had heard the grim reaper greet him. Even my Gumpelino, alas, I did not get to meet him. That noble soul had just given up his great and glorious spirit, and a seraph now he hovers round Jehovah's throne or near it. The bow-legged Adonis I sought in vain, who used to dilly-dally, as he hawked china cups and chamber pots in every Hamburg alley. That loyal poodle Ceres is dead, how Kampa mourned the blighter. I'd wager he'd prefer to lose the life of many a writer. The population of Hamburg consists within the memory of all the living. Of Jews and Christians, the latter too are not much accustomed to giving. The Christians act all well enough and eat well enough to stay them. And they pay their bills very promptly too, even before they have to pay them. The Jews divide between two different sides. The division is quite simple. The old ones go to the synagogue, and the new ones to the temple. The new ones eat pork, are Democrats, and are fractious in society. The old ones run to aristocrats, the aristocratic variety. I love the old ones, I love the new, I love them all to the letter. But I know certain fish that are called smoked sprats, and I love those fish still better.
Part 23. The Republic of Hamburg was never so great as Venice was or Florence, but Hamburg has better oysters. You get the best at the Café Lorenz. It was a fine evening when Kampe and I went there for a dinner meeting. We wanted the Rhinish wine for drink, and the oysters for succulent eating. Besides, I found good company there, with pleasure I saw among others, many old comrades like Schroffe P, and also many new brothers. There's Villet, whose face is an album which, academic foes and betters, have written their inscriptions in very legible letters. There's Fuchs, a bitter heathen and a personal foe of Jehovah, who believes in Hegel alone, and a bit in the Venus of Canova. My Kampe played Amphitryon, with smiling face politeness. His eyes shone with beatitude, like a Madonna's beaming brightness. I thought to myself as dinner went on, and I gobbled and guzzled freely, this Kampe is really a very great man, the prince of publishers really.
Another perhaps would let me starve. It might not even grieve him. But this one even gives me wine. I'll certainly never leave him. I thank the Lord who made the grape and the vines that cling and kiss earth, and gave me Julius Campe as my publisher on this earth. I thank the Lord whose mighty word tells nature to replenish the oysters growing in the sea and on the land the Rhenish. Who made the lemons grow to squirt the oysters as he blessed them? Tonight, Lord, grant that I shall have the stomach to digest them. The Rhenish melts all spite and spleen. It soothes my breast, it mellows. It always kindles in my soul a love for all my fellows. It drives me out to roam the streets. It fills me with desire. My soul seeks a soul. I look for one in dainty white attire. At times like this, I nearly melt with tender, wistful yearning. All cats seem gray, all women fair, as Helen and set me burning. And when I reached the Drebin there, I saw her, moonlight crested, a splendid woman, nobly built and wonderfully high-breasted. Her face was round and fresh and sound, her eyes were a blue turquoise study, cheeks like roses, cherry lips, even the nose was rather ruddy. Her head was topped by a linen cap with stiff white corrugations. It looked like a folded mural crown with turrets and crenellations. She wore a white tunic down to her calves, and oh, what calves, high and solemn. The pedestal rose to the legs, each leg looked like a Doric column. In every feature one saw she was a lady of worldly acumen. But what proved her godly rank was this, her posterior was superhuman. She came right up and spoke to me, "Welcome to Elbe, albeit. You've been away for 13 years, you're still the same, I see it. Perhaps you're seeking those beautiful souls, all amiable and pretty, who helped you revel through the night in this beautiful part of the city. That hundred-headed monster, life, has swallowed them up forever. You'll never bring back those vanished days, nor those girls you knew. No, never. Those lovely flowers that bloomed here once, in which your young heart delighted, you'll find them no more. They're withered now, and the storms have left them blighted. They're withered, blighted, crushed by the tread of destiny's cruel feet now. My friend, that is ever the earthly lot of all that is fair and sweet now. Who are you? I cried. You stare like a dream from the past, soon faded to wither. Where do you live, majestic dame, and may I accompany you thither? She smiled and said, that's your mistake. I'm afraid you misconceive me. I'm decent, moral, and very refined. I'm not what you believe me. I'm not one of those Gallic drabs, or a tart from the Lorette sector. No, then, I am Harmonia, Omberg's goddess protector. You're startled. You even seem afraid. You're usually valiant singer. Do you still have a mind to come with me? Very well then, let's not linger. But I laughed aloud and cried to her, I'll follow you, fair immortal. Stride on before, I'll follow you, even to hell's own portal. Part 24. How I climbed up her narrow stairs is beyond my imagination. Perhaps invisible spirits helped, by means of levitation. There, in Harmonia's little room, some hours were enough to restore me. The goddess confessed she'd always felt considerable sympathy for me. You see, she said, in former days, there was no one I prized higher than the singer who sang the Messiah on his piously plangent lyre. My Klopstock's bust sits on the chest. That's the place it long has sat on. But for years it served me only as a perch to hang my hat on. Now you're my favorite, over my bed. See your picture and what surrounds it? Your portrait circled with laurel leaves, and a fresh-cut wreathlet crowns it. Only, you've carped at my dear son so much, and you must know it. You deeply wounded me sometimes. I think you'd better stow it. I hope that time has cured you of your habit of behaving badly, and that at last it's taught you how to suffer fools more gladly. But tell me, how did this trip of yours occur to you altogether? It's not the season for traveling, it's already wintry weather. Ah, my goddess, I answered her, there's often a hidden reason that slumbers deep in the human heart and wakes up at the wrong season. Outwardly happy, yet my heart was heavy, something ailed me. This oppressive feeling grew every day, homesickness had assailed me. The air of France, so specially light, felt heavy like any other. I had to breathe German air again, or else I'd stifle and smother. The reek of peat and German pipes, this my heart was demanding. My feet itched with impatient need on the German soil to be standing. At night I sighed with longing to see the old lady, how I missed her. She lives not far from the Damter now, and near her lives Lottie, my sister. And also that noble old gentleman, my thoughts of him sighed through me. For though he always scolded me out, he always was generous to me. To hear him say, "Stupid lad," again, would have given me great pleasure. It always echoed through my heart, with the lilt of a musical measure. I longed for German chimney smoke, for the nightingales that chorused in Lower Saxony's heatherlands, for a silent beech tree forest. I even longed once more to see the places that remind me of where I wore my crown of thorns and dragged youth's cross behind me. I yearned to weep where once I felt the bitterest tears fall burning. I think it's love of country that they call this foolish yearning. I don't like to talk of it. It is a sickness of sick fixation. I always hide my wound in shame from public observation. I hate the dirty pack of rogues who move your heart by cunning, by putting their patriotism out for show with all its ulcers running. It's shabby, shameless beggars they are. They stick out a hand for charity, for Menzel and his Swabians pleas a penny for popularity. My goddess, you find me soft-hearted today. I'm feeling somewhat sickly, but if I take care of myself a bit, I'll recover very quickly. Yes, yes, I'm sick, but you can lift my spirits in a minute. Just give me a good hot cup of tea and put some good rum in it.
Part 25. The goddess made me a cup of tea and put some good rum in it, but she herself drank down the rum without any tea to thin it. She leaned her head to rest upon my shoulder consequently. Her crowning cap was somewhat creased, and she spoke to me very gently. I've often thought with horror how you live with all your laurels in wicked Paris among the French, who are known to have no morals. And there you loaf around the town, and don't even have beside you an honest German publisher to counsel you and guide you. And there temptation is so great from sylphs who all are sickly, it isn't hard for you to lose your peace of mind quite quickly. Stay here with us, where decency still reigns, one can't deny it. And yet there's many a pleasure found among us on the quiet. Stay here with us in Germany, you'll find it less distressing. We're making strides, you've seen no doubt how far we are progressing. Even the censorship's less harsh, Hoffman's eased up on his strictures, and slashes no more with youthful rage as he did your travel pictures. You're older and milder now yourself, and less inclined to fight now. You'll even see the past, I think, in a somewhat rosier light now. To say that German affairs were grim is exaggeration, really. As in Rome, a slave could always escape by cutting his throat quite freely. The people enjoyed real freedom of thought. The masses' rights were respected. The few who insisted on publishing things were the only ones affected. No lawless tyranny reigned over us, demagogues, no matter how awful, were always stripped of their citizenship by decrees that were perfectly lawful. In spite of hard times, things didn't go so bad with the German nation. In a German prison, believe you me, no man ever died of starvation. The good old days had a certain charm. The fairest flowers were sprouting of faith and devotion and kindliness. Now all is negation and doubting. This practical outward liberty will someday destroy willy-nilly the ideal that we carry within our breasts, which is pure as the dream of a lily. Our beautiful poetry sinking fast on the deathbed where it's lying. The Moorish king of Freiligraths, like other kings, is dying. Our sons won't starve, but they'll not sup while quietly meditating. A spectacle drama is rumbling near, the idols terminating. If you'd keep quiet to you, I would unseal the book of fate here, and let my magic mirror show the future of the state here. I've never shown it to a mortal man, but I'd like you to descry it. The shape of the coming Germany, but ah, you can't keep quiet. My God, O goddess, I cried in delight, that's an offer to be snapped up. Let me see the future Germany, I'm the man to keep it wrapped up. I'll swear you any oath you like, I've plenty, I'll not spare it. To guarantee that I won't talk, tell me how should I swear it? She answered, swear in the manner set by Father Abraham's tradition, the way he had Eleazar swear when he sent him on his mission. Lift up my robe and lay your hand here on my thigh, reciting your heartfelt oath of secrecy in speaking and in writing. A solemn moment, I felt a breath of the past blow from the pages of history as I swore that oath in the fashion of bygone ages. I lifted the goddess' robe and laid my hand on her thigh, reciting that solemn oath of secrecy in speaking and in writing. Part 26. The cheeks of the goddess glowed very red. I think that the rum had mounted right up to her crown in wistful tones. This is what she recounted. I'm getting old, after all. I was born the day that Omberg was founded. My mother was queen of the herring here, by Elba's water surrounded. My father was one of the greatest kings, Carolus Magnus the Kaiser, mightier even than Frederick the Great of Prussia, and also wiser. At Aachen's, the seat on which he sat, at his crowning richly merited, the seat on which he sat at night, my good old mother inherited. My mother left it to me, it is, nothing special, so you can tell it. But if Rothschild offered me all his wealth, I wouldn't be willing to sell it. Do you see? It's in the corner there, old, torn, and weather-beaten. The leather's ripped from off the back, and the cushion is all moth-eaten. But go and lift that cushion up, that cushion so soiled and spotty. Behold, you'll see a circular hole, and under it a potty. It is an enchanted pot in which there are magical forces brewing. And stick your head into the hole, it's the future you'll be viewing. The future of Germany before your eyes, like a billowing phantasm. But do not shudder it from the mess, exhales a foul miasm. She spoke and laughed, a peculiar laugh, but I wasn't afraid for a minute. I eagerly went to the fearsome hole and stuck my head right in it. The things I saw there I can't reveal, my oath makes it unlawful. But I can tell you this much now, my God, the smell was awful. It turns my stomach still to think of those odors blended together. A cursedly vile foreshadowing smell, rotten cabbage plus Russian leather. What dreadful aromas were wafted up, my God, what frightful stenches. As if the filth were being flushed from 36 sewer trenches. The Committee of Public Safety was told by St. Just once to their noses, you can't cure grave ills of society with musk and altar of roses. But this scent of the German futurity was ever so much stronger than anything I ever smelled. I could bear it now no longer.
My senses failed, and when I woke, still at her side I rested, my head on the goddess's bosom, which was sufficiently ample-breasted. Her lips were on fire, her nostrils twitched, the gleam in her eyes was bacchantic. She clasped the poet in ecstasy, her song was wild and frantic. I love you, stay here in Hamburg with me, eating and drinking, consuming the oysters and wine of the present hour, forget the dark days that are looming. Put the cover back, our joy is crowned, let no small smell overthrow it. I love you as no woman before ever loved a German poet. I kiss you, see your genius fills my heart with inspiration. My soul is in the power of a strange intoxication. I seem to hear the watchman's song go ringing through the city. It's a wedding song, my darling dear. It's Hymen's nuptial ditty. The footmen now are coming too, with torches burning brightly. They gravely dance, the torchlight dance. They hop and spring so lightly. Here comes the illustrious Senate now. The councilmen take their station. The burgomaster clears his throat. He plans to make an oration. Now see the bright-dressed diplomats from all the neighbor nations. They present themselves with due reserve to offer congratulations. Here's the clerical delegation now, rabbis and pastors vying. But woe, see Hoffman come along with those censor shears he's plying. The shears are clicking in his hand, he plunges like a possessed one. Upon your body hacks the flesh. Alas, that part was the best one. Part 27. Whatever else took place that night of magic powers, I'll tell you about it some other time, in warmer summer hours. The old generation of hypocrites, today, thank God, is dying. It's slowly perishing, done to death, by its own disease of lying. A new generation is growing up, without any shamming and sinning. It's free in thought and free in joy, I'll proclaim a new beginning. A burgeoning youth knows the poet's worth and pride, and is his defender, and warms itself upon his heart, and in his sunny splendor. My heart is loving like the light, and pure and chaste like fire. The noblest graces have attuned the strings of my poet's lyre. It is the selfsame lyre that once my father used to finger, the late Mr. Aristophanes, the muse's favorite singer. It is the lyre on which he sang how Pistheteros courted fair Basilia and bore her up where cloudlands soared and sported. In the previous chapter I made an attempt, it was one of my caprices, to copy the end of my father's The Birds, surely the best of his pieces. The Frogs is also an excellent play, they're staging a German translation, right now in a theater in Berlin for His Majesty's declamation. The king likes the play that shows his taste, it's classical, roughly speaking. The old king found more amusement in modern frogs croaking and creaking. The king likes the play, were the author alive, however I'd urge this opinion, he'd be wise not to come in person to make a visit to Prussia's dominion. The real Aristophanes would have a bad time, he soon would come to abhor us. We'd see him go round, accompanied by a troop of gendarmes as chorus. The mob would soon get the word to spit instead of fawning around him. The police would be ordered to dog his tracks, to harass him and hound him. O king, I wish you well, so here's advice with no misgiving. Honor dead poets, if you will, but take care of those that are living. Never offend any poet alive, they have weapons of flame calculated to be deadlier than Jove's thunderbolts, which in fact the poets created. Offend the gods, both old and new, and the whole crew who attend them, plus mighty Jehovah himself besides, but the poets don't offend them. To be sure the gods punish strictly enough a human being's misdoing, and the fires of hell are fairly hot to one who is roasting and stewing. Yet there are saints whose prayers release burning sinners from their transgressions, and church donations and masses will gain high-level intercessions. and Christ will descend in the final days to smash open hell's dark portal. And however stern the judgment will be, there will be mercy for many a mortal. But there are hells from which there is no possible liberation, where neither the Savior's pardon nor any prayers can bring salvation. Don't you know the hell that Dante limned in his terrible lines, did you see them? Those whom the poet imprisoned there, no God can ever free them. No God, no Savior can deliver them from these singing flames, no never. Beware lest we condemn you too to such a hell forever.